part of the chapter that I wanted to look at was there in verse 19, where the Bible read, "And the men of the city said unto Elisha, Behold, I pray thee, the situation of this city is pleasant, as my Lord seeth, but the water is not, and the ground barren. And he said, Bring me a new cruse, and put salt therein. And they brought it to him. And he went forth unto the spring of the waters, and cast the salt in there, and said, Thus saith the Lord, I have healed these waters. There shall not be from thence any more death or barren land. So the waters were healed unto this day, according to the saying of Elisha, which he spake." The title of the sermon tonight is Salt is Good. Salt is good. Turn, if you would, to Mark chapter 9 in your New Testament. Flip over there to Mark chapter 9. So we see, this is an interesting chapter. There's a lot of really cool things going on. And I think sometimes people would skip over this part of this chapter. Because, I mean, you have Elijah taken up in a whirlwind to heaven. You have Elisha parting the waters and coming back. We see the Spirit of God is resting on Elisha. And really the first miracle that he does, I guess, is crossing these waters. But then we see the second miracle he does is he takes a cruse, just like a pot or a jar of salt, and he pours it into the springs of water in this city where they have no fruit. I mean, the ground's just barren. They're like, man, it looks really nice here. You know, it's really cool, but the waters just aren't right. You know, we're not getting any fruit. The land's barren. So he takes this salt and he pours it into the waters. And then God says, I've healed your land, and no more shall it be barren. And then we look at Mark chapter 9. Look there at verse 49. It's a pretty long chapter. In verse 49, the Bible says, "For everyone shall be salted with fire, and every sacrifice shall be salted with salt." Salt is good. But if the salt have lost its saltness, wherewith will ye season it? Have salt in yourselves, and have peace one with another. You know, it kind of reminds me of the verse when the Bible says, "Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them." You know, I think when it's talking about salt, there's different things that we can look at, but salt sometimes I think is representing the Word of God. And if you have the laws of God, if you have the Word of God, you can have peace. He says, have the salt in yourselves. Get that Word of God in yourselves. And when you think of salt, I think salt's something that everybody, you know, knows what it is. I mean, everybody's used salt, everybody's tasted salt. I looked at it online, just some human definitions of salt. It said that salt is essential for life in general. And saltiness is one of the basic human tastes. The tissues of animals contain larger quantities of salt than do plant tissues. Salt is one of the oldest and most ubiquitous food seasonings. And salting is an important method of food preservation. So we see salt's an important part of our life. It's a part of everyday life. It's essential for life. This is not the King James Bible. They're saying that, you know, salt's important. You know, even the secular viewpoint. They say we have to have salt. It keeps everything in balance. You know, it helps with moisture and different things. There was another article I saw when I was talking about salt. Said salt, sodium chloride. So that's the chemical composition. It says most people have heard of Smithfield hams. These hams can last forever because they are salt cured. Salt has been used since ancient times, particularly for meat, as a preservative. The salt enters the tissue and binds the water, inhibiting the bacterium that causes spoilage. The salt restricts to tiny concentration and protects food from yeasts and molds. It draws out moisture and it creates an environment inhospitable to bacteria. Now, if you mean you're paying attention to what this is saying, it's saying when you have the salt in this ham, you know, it's going to be protected. It's going to be preserved. It's going to be inhospitable to bacteria, to virus, to disease. Now, what's the spiritual application of that? I think it's pretty obvious. When you get the Word of God in your heart, when you're filled with God's laws, it's going to be inhospitable to sin. I mean, it's hard to be filling yourself with this book and be constantly wanting to live in the world, constantly wanting to be filled with sin. And we see when you get the salt in you, it's going to be preservative. It's going to help keep that stuff off of you. It's going to help protect you against those things. What's going to protect you from sin? The Word of God. What's going to help protect you stop sinning? The fear of God, which you get from reading this book.
Amen.
And we see salt is good. Salt is an important thing in our lives. Go to Luke chapter 14. We're going to see the same thing. It's interesting how God gives us so many illustrations in the Bible that are like an earthly example, that are just things that are common to us, that we see every day. And He can take that and make a great spiritual application. He can show us great things from His Word, just from a common thing like salt. I mean, salt's something everybody has. You can't go to someone's house and they don't have salt. Look at verse 34. It says, salt is good, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land, nor yet for the dunghill, but men cast it out. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. So the Bible's saying, look, he's making a spiritual application when he's talking about salt. You know, obviously I think salt's good. I mean, I like the taste of salt. But that's not what Jesus Christ is really talking about. He's saying, he that hath ears, let him hear. So he wanted to teach you something really important when he was talking about this salt. So let's back up. Let's look at verse 4. Let's look at verse 15. So go up, Luke chapter 14, verse 15. See what Jesus was saying. He said, and when one of them that sat at meat with him heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they are with one consent, being to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, and the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you, that none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper. So you see, he's talking to his disciples, and he's talking to them in a parable. And he's saying, look, imagine me being God, being a servant, and being the master of the house, sending out his servant, and trying to bid to the marriage, meaning coming to marriage supper of the Lamb, coming to heaven, to be in his kingdom. And the people that were bid, they didn't want to come. But he says to his servant, you know what? We're not done here. No. Go out and invite the poor, the blind, the lame, the maimed, the halt. Go bring them in. And he gets all of them in. Then he says, there's more room. So he goes out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in that his house may be filled. So when we see at the bottom, he's talking about that salt. He's talking about being, you know, the salt is good, right? He's talking to his disciples. And he's talking about how with that salt, they're going to go out and they're going to get people saved with the Word of God. They're going to go out and they're going to preach the gospel and they're going to get people saved. But he's saying if the salt's lost its seasoning, if it's lost its savor, how are you going to go out and get the highways and hedges saved? How are you going to get these people saved if you don't have the Word of God with you? If you're not seasoned with that salt? And we're going to look at some other scriptures later that kind of illustrate that point. But look at verse 25. Let's keep going in this chapter. He says, and there went great multitudes with them. And he turned and said unto them, if any man come to me, and hate not his father and his mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he hath sufficient to finish it, lest happily, after he hath laid the foundation, he is not able to finish it. All that behold, it began to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 men to meet him, that cometh against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, and he sendeth an embassage, and desireth conditions of peace, so likewise, whosoever he be of you, that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land, nor yet for the dunghill. But men cast it out. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. So when he's talking about the salt, who is he talking about? Well, you got to back up. He's talking about the servants that are going out and preaching the gospel. They're bidding them to come to the marriage. He's bidding not just the poor, the blind, the maimed, everybody. He's going to the highways and hedges. He's preaching the gospel. Then he comes down here and he says, look, if you're not willing to forsake all your family, you can't be my disciple. He says, if you're not willing to forsake all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. And look, he says, salt is good. So what he's saying, look, it's good to be saved. It's good to be a Christian. But if the salt loses its saltiness, if it loses its savor, if it loses its seasoning, It's good for nothing. It's not going to go out there and preach the gospel. It's not going to go out there and compel people to come in. He's not going to be a disciple of God. And it's going to be worthless. He's just going to cast it out. It means good for nothing, according to the Bible. It says it's neither fit for the land. So how is God going to heal the land with bad salt? I mean, when Elisha had that cruise of salt, he was pouring good salt into those waters. And then God healed the land. How is America going to get saved? How is America going to get right with God? By the salt. We need the men to go out and preach the gospel, to go in the highways and the hedges, and to be his disciple. To decide, you know what? God's more important than my family. God's more important than my wife, than my kids, than my brother, than my sister. I'm going to forsake all for the cause of Christ.
Amen.
Now, of course, the Bible's not teaching that you just have to, oh, I'm just going to leave my wife, and I'm going to leave my kids, and I'm going to not care about them. I mean, obviously, to be a pastor, it says you have to have a wife. You have to have children. You have to rule well your own house. But what he's trying to say is, in comparison, if you have to make a hard decision between the two, who are you going to try and please more? God or your wife? God or your family? God or your children? Now, of course, to be right with God, you better be taking care of your wife. You better be taking care of your children. That's part of God's commandments. But you can't be his disciple if when you're put in a hard rock situation, you say, oh man, you know, my wife really doesn't like this. I guess I'm just going to give up. I guess I'm just going to lose that saltiness. I guess I'm just going to lose that savor. If you say, oh man, you know, I'm going to lose my relationship with my kids if I follow Christ. If I go and I preach this way, if I go to this church, if I do these things. You know, my kid, he wants me to go play golf with me every weekend, but I want to go soul winning. What are you going to choose? Are you going to forsake that relationship? Now, of course, look, you can have a relationship with your family. You say, hey, son, I want you to go soul winning with me. I want you to come to church with me. I want you to read the Bible with me. That's what we should be like. We should say, come see my zeal for the Lord.
Right. Amen.
But when you're putting the rock in the hard place, when you have to make that decision, you know, and I think pretty much everybody that wants to live for God, the Bible says that all that will live godly will suffer persecution, right? I mean, if you're willing to live for God, there's going to be people in your family that don't. There's going to be people in your family that wanted to be detractors. They don't want to, you know, follow with you. And you have to make that decision. Am I going to be God's disciple? What happened, though? If all the Christians, I mean, being a Christian is great. I mean, being saved is great. Isn't amen? People that got saved tonight, people that get saved every week, that's great. Yep. But what if all the Christians stopped preaching God's word?
Right.
What if we just all quit soul winning? What if we all quit reading the Bible? What if we all quit going to church? It's good for nothing. We're going to lose this world. We're not going to have fruit. It's going to be a barren land. We need the salt. Where are we going to get the healing? Where are you going to get healing without the salt? The Bible says pleasant words are as in honeycomb, sweet to the soul, and health to the bones. You know you're going to get health from God's word. And the Bible is saying, look, it's salt. You need this salt so that it can be sweet on the soul. It can be health under your bones. Turn to Numbers chapter 18. Go back to the Old Testament, Numbers. So I was given a little bit of an introduction. The first point of the sermon is that salt is a preservative. You know, and I think that's just really common. It's really obvious. I mean, we read two definitions of what the world says, and they say it's a really common preservative. It's used for meats. It's used for a lot of different things. But according to the Bible, even salt is a preservative. And I'll read for you in 2 Chronicles chapter 13 this really interesting wording, I think, that the Bible says. But in verse 3, it said, "And Abijah set the battle in array with an army of valiant men of war, even 400,000 chosen men. Jeroboam also set the battle in array against him with 800,000 chosen men, being mighty men of valor. And Abijah stood up upon Mount Zemarim, which is in Mount Ephraim, and said, Hear me, thou Jeroboam and all Israel. Ought ye not to know that the Lord God of Israel gave the kingdom over Israel to David forever, even to him and to his sons, by a covenant of salt?" So the Bible uses this phrase, covenant of salt. And at first I was kind of like, what does that mean? What is he saying? Like a covenant of salt? Like they maybe got some salt together and rubbed it. I mean, what is he saying? He's just saying, look, he gave the kingdom to David forever. Now, what is salt? It's a preservative. So he's saying, look, it's a covenant of salt in the way that he preserved them. He's going to always preserve the kingdom of David. Through who? Jesus Christ, right?
Amen.
I mean, we see that all of David's descendants ruled on the throne all the way to Jesus Christ, who will rule and reign forever.
Amen.
An eternal kingdom. So he's saying a covenant of salt, meaning, look, it's going to last forever. It's going to be preservative. Even though this said, look, when you salt that ham, it lasts forever. Look at Numbers 18, verse 19. And all the heave offerings of the holy things, which the children of Israel offer unto the Lord, have I given thee, and thy sons and thy daughters with thee, by a statute forever. It is a covenant of salt forever before the Lord unto thee, and to thy seed with thee. So again, when he's talking to the priest, he's saying, look, I'm going to make a covenant with you, and it's going to be forever. It's going to be a covenant of salt. And so that's a really interesting phrase in the Bible. But he's just saying he's going to be preserving. He's going to preserve them. He's going to keep them forever. And salt is going to preserve this world. Salt is going to preserve this place. Turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. I'll read for you. In Proverbs chapter 14, the Bible says, "In the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride, but the lips of the wise shall preserve them." So the Bible says, look, a foolish person, the things that come out of his mouth, the pride, it's going to be a rod to his back. It's not going to be beneficial to him. People think that, oh, I got to talk about how great I am. It's just going to be a rod. It's never going to help you. And the Bible says, the lips of the wise shall preserve them. Think about getting that salt inside you and those words coming out, that's going to preserve you. Getting that salt, getting the word of God. Proverbs chapter 2 says, "Discretion shall preserve thee, understanding shall keep thee." This Bible is what's going to preserve your life. This Bible is going to keep your life. This Bible is going to keep you on the right track. The Word of God, you got to get that salt in your life so it'll preserve you. But just not you. We don't just care about you. We care about everybody. Preach the gospel to the whole world. How are you going to save the world? They got to get this salt. And it's interesting when you think about the first time that salt was mentioned in the Bible. God was looking at a city, a very wicked city. And he was debating whether or not he was going to destroy it. And he said, look, if there's 50 righteous people, I won't destroy the city. Isn't that interesting? That a Christian, a man of God, the salt, is going to preserve this city. I mean, just think about that. What's going to preserve God from destroying America? Salt. What's going to destroy it? Christians on fire for God, living for Him. That's what's going to preserve this world. He went all the way down to 10 people. He said, look, if there was even just 10 people in this city of Sodom and Gomorrah, he said, I would preserve it. But you know, there wasn't 10 people. And when Lot and his wife left, it's interesting, she turned back. She didn't want to live for God. And guess what she became? A pillar of salt. Isn't that ironic? Isn't it ironic that salt's going to preserve this city? And she's not willing to do it, and then she turns back, she just becomes a pillar of salt. Now, I don't think it was the good salt. It was the one that was good for nothing. That would just be cast out. So now they're fit for the land. We see, I'll read you one other place. It says in Matthew 11, "And now Capernaum, which art exalted into heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day." Look, even Sodom, at some point, even though they were so wicked, if somebody had gone there and just been preaching the Word of God, had been doing wonderful works, they could have repented and been right. It could have remained unto this day. It could have been preserved. But why wasn't it preserved? Didn't have any salt. It just didn't have anybody there to preach the Word of God. There was no salt coming out. See, when Lot was talking to the people and he was condemning them, they were like, he must needs be a judge. It kind of seemed to imply that he was never really judging them before that. Because it was the first time he was going to give them any kind of judgment. Look at 2 Chronicles chapter 7, where had you turn. Look at verse 14. "If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land." It's a very famous verse, but the very end of it says he'll heal their land. Look, the salt healed the land. What God makes it very clear. It's so consistent through the Bible. You want to heal this land? You want to heal this country? You want to heal this city? You want to heal your family? It's got to be a salt. You got to get that salt in your life. You got to get this Word of God. You got to be salty. You got to have good seasoning. The Bible says, "Whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it. And whosoever shall lose his life shall preserve it." Look, just lose your life into this book. Just say, I don't care about my desires. I don't care about what, you know, I want to do this great thing. Just give that up and go for God and you'll preserve it.
Amen.
How are you going to preserve your life? With salt. By doing God's word. By living and following his commandments. That's how you're going to preserve your life. You're not going to do it by trying to keep it. You know, it's interesting. People even take salt and they put it on the sidewalk. You know, when it snows outside or it rains. Why do they do that? It's so people won't fall. Right? Go to Psalms chapter 12. I'll read for you in 1 Timothy 6. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. We see that a lot of people are falling into sin. Well, how are you going to stop them from falling? Why, being the salt to them. If you say for the love of money, or you say the love of money is the root of all evil, if you've gotten, you preach the word of God, if you're giving them some salt, you can help them not stumble. Now, of course, if somebody just really wants to fall, they're going to fall. I mean, you can't just protect everybody. But at least if you got a little bit of salt on the sidewalk, it might help some people get, you know, right with God. So they won't fall into temptation. They won't fall into a snare. Amen. Look at Psalms chapter 12. Let's read this whole chapter. I like this chapter. Help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. They speak vanity, every one with his neighbor. With flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak. The Lord shall cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaketh proud things, who have said, with our tongue we will prevail. Our lips are our own. Who is Lord over us? For the oppression of the poor, for the sighing of the needy. Now will I arise, saith the Lord. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth at him. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in the furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. The wicked walk on every side when the vilest men are exalted. We see that God's always going to preserve his word. This is the ultimate salt right here. And if you want to preserve your life, you got to get it. But we see when the godly man ceases, when the word of God is not being preached, the vilest men walk on every side. We see that that's so true in America. We see, why is our country falling apart? Why do we have so many wicked leaders? Why do we have the wicked literally walking on every side? Because this word of God is not being preached. Because we don't have enough salt. Because we don't have anybody going out and preaching the word of God with boldness. We don't have enough salt in this world. We need more salt. So the first point is, salt is going to preserve us. Salt is going to preserve our church. Salt is going to preserve our city. Salt is going to preserve our nation. Salt is going to preserve the world even. Think about the rapture. Why is it that God waits to pour out his wrath? Because he's got to get all the salt out first. He's got to get all the Christians out. He's going to rapture the Christians. Then he's going to pour out his wrath. Because there's nothing preserving it anymore. It's all gone.
Yeah. That's good.
The second point is that salt is a seasoning. I mean, when we think about salt, it's pretty obvious, right? I mean, it's something you use to season your food. You put it on food. We need the Word of God to be, you know, we need the Word of God so we can be effectively seasoned, so that we can have the right taste. Go to Colossians chapter 4. Colossians chapter 4. The Bible says in Proverbs 15, it says, a man hath joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season, how good is it? I mean, the words of God are so good. A word spoken in due season. He's saying, man, when you're just struggling, when you're down in your luck, maybe you're going through some persecution, and then that one verse just comes to mind. Or someone just gives you that one good Bible verse, and it just clicks. It's just so, how good is it when you have the word of God? The Bible says, the heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. We need to study this word so we can have our salt be really salty. So it can be really seasoned really well. Look at Colossians chapter 4, verse 6. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. He's saying, look, how are you going to know how to answer every man? How are you going to speak right when you're talking to people? It's got to be seasoned with salt. It's got to be seasoned with this Bible. I love hearing people when they just talk, and this Bible is coming out. I mean, when you go out soul winning, the best soul winners are the ones where it's just Bible coming out. I mean, it's just verse after verse. They're comparing spiritual with spiritual, and it's just coming all together. It's just seasoned with salt. It's got so much flavor. It's got so much savor. It's got so much of a bite. And you know, good salt, you always taste it. I mean, you never like have bad. I mean, if you have really good salt, you can't put it in anything and not taste it. I mean, it's just, think about like a huge glass of water, and you just put a little bit of salt. I mean, you're going to taste that. It's like, ugh. It's got some savor to it, right? Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. I'll read for you a couple more verses. It says, that I might make thee know the certainty of the words of truth, that thou mightest answer the words of truth to them that send unto thee. Look, we got to have the words of truth. That's how we're going to answer people. We need the salt. Salt is good, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? The Bible's saying, look, if you're saved, but then you're not getting seasoned with this book, how are you going to get any seasoning? I mean, if you lose your savor, if you lose your fervor for God, if you're not excited about the things of God, you get out of church, how are you going to get, and you don't want to read this book, how are you ever going to get seasoned? How are you ever going to get right with God? How are you going to do good things with God? No, you need this book. You need these things. This is how you're going to get your seasoning. This is how you're going to get your taste. This is how you're going to get your savor. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, for we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ, in them that are saved, and in them that perish. Look, we are a sweet savor unto God when we're living for Him, when we're doing the good things. Think about good salt. I mean, it has a good savor unto God. It says in them that are saved, the Bible makes it very clear that if we want God to be pleased with us, we have to follow His commandments. It says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So we think about good salt, but, you know, having a lot of good salt, let's say you had a packet of salt and you were eating with your dinner, okay? And you had a certain amount, and you had this big plate of food. Now, when you have the salt and you're going to put it on your food, you just want to put it all in one little spot. I just think, you got some meat, you got some potatoes, you got some vegetables, you got this salt, and you're like, I'm just going to pour it all on the meat. I mean, I'm just going to, like, just load it up with all the salt. Now, is that going to be the best thing? Or do you kind of want the salt to be evenly distributed? Or maybe think you had a plate of vegetables, and you decided to put it all on one of the vegetables, instead of kind of like mixed all in or whatever. I mean, you kind of want it to be spread. You kind of want it to be distributed. Why? So that you can get it on everything. So that everything can have that savor. Everything can have that taste. Just like the Bible. I mean, just think about a Christian who decides, you know what? I'm just going to be about King James only. That's the only thing I care about. I'm only going to study that issue. That's the only thing I care about. I mean, are they going to be the most effective Christian? Are they going to be, you know, pleasing God the best that they possibly can? No, God wants us to be evenly distributed across the Bible, right? He wants to have a good savor in all things. He wants us not just be King James only, or not just be prophecy, or not just be soul winning. He wants the whole Bible. He wants all of it. He wants you to, you know, get every single piece of this book into your heart. He wants you to be well distributed. You know, even that of the world. Think about Faith Lord Baptist Church. Pastor Anderson makes it very clear that he doesn't want to build some great big temple and just have everybody come into him and just try to make Jerusalem on earth. No, he wants to send people out. He wants the people to go into other cities, to go to other nations, to go to all kinds of places in the world. He wants to spread his salt. He wants to get the salt in the whole world so that we can get more people saved, so that we can preserve more people, so they can get more of the savor of God to more places.
Amen. It's good.
You know, you think about putting salt, good seasoning, or you'll always notice it. I mean, so many times when you talk about seasonings, I don't know if you've ever heard anything about seasonings. The way seasonings are measured or their value is based on how much seasoning they really have. You can just put like a little dash of it, and it's going to be much more than something that you have to put a lot. I mean, you think about spices like cayenne pepper, or you think about just pepper itself, or salt, or garlic, any of these things. If you can put just a little bit of dash, and it has more potency, more flavor, it's considered more value. And so that's the same with salt. With our salt, we need to be able to notice it. We need to be able to see it. And think about, I have this time when I was growing up, where I would like get up in the middle of the night and I would just wander the fridge. I'd be like so thirsty. I'd like wake up and my throat was like so dry and it was like hurting almost. And I was like, I have to go get a drink of water or get a drink of something. And so I like stumbled in and I opened up the fridge and I saw like a half drink in Coke. And now I don't usually like to drink Coke when I'm really thirsty, but I was just so thirsty. It was the only thing I saw. And I was like, I'll just take a swig of this. You know, and it wasn't mine. I didn't know whose it was. But so I just grabbed this Coke bottle and I take a big old swig of it. And then I just spew it everywhere. I like almost vomit. Because what had happened is my dad loves to put peanuts in his Coke. He would put all these peanuts in his Coke, and then he'd drink the Coke and eat the peanuts up. But what happens is all that salt on those peanuts gets dissolved in that Coke, and it tastes awful. I mean, it tastes horrible. And so I just unsuspecting just take this big Coke bottle and just like, ugh! But I immediately noticed it. I mean, I wasn't like confused. I was like, wow, that's disgusting. But you know, even like my grandfather, he likes to eat watermelon. You know, he lives in Kentucky, loves to eat watermelon. And I remember he likes to salt his watermelons. I mean, that is the worst thing in the world. Amen. I mean, I get this big piece of watermelon. I'm like, it tastes so good. I got the sugar. And then I take a big old bite and I'm like, ew, what is this? Why are you putting salt on the watermelon? But you know, the interesting thing is you couldn't see it. I mean, I walked up unsuspecting and I said, hey, what is this? But then I took a big old bite out of it and I knew exactly what was happening. And I think that with the Christians in today, I mean, we're supposed to be in the world, but we're not supposed to be of the world. I mean, you can't just look at somebody and know, oh, this guy's a man, you know, man of God. He's on fire because he's wearing a dress, and he's got his collar on backward, and he's got a big cross, and he's just saying, hallelujah, hallelujah, walking us. That's not how we know. I mean, you know a man of God by what comes out of his mouth, his saltiness. That's how you can see a man of God, following God's commandments. But, you know, even salt can sometimes be irritating. Right? I mean, it's sometimes, I think about the illustration of putting some salt in some water. Now, sometimes you maybe get sick. Maybe you get a sore throat. You know, I've gotten a sore throat, and I took a big glass of water, and I put a bunch of salt in it, and I would gargle. It actually gave a lot of relief. But I'll tell you, I hated every second of it. I mean, it was awful. And the same thing is sometimes with God's Word. Sometimes when you have God's Word pounding down on the sin in your life, it hurts. It's uncomfortable. It's irritating. You don't like it. But it's good for you. It's going to bring healing into your life. And who would have thought that putting salt in water would bring healing? Oh yeah, that was the Bible. Oh yeah, that was Elisha by the Word of God. He put salt in the waters and it brought healing unto the land. How many people today put salt in the water for healing today? But that brings me to my third point. Why are we needing the healing? Why are we needing to add the salt to the water? Third point is that salt will help bring forth fruit. The whole point of this is to bring forth fruit. We need the salt to bring forth fruit.
Amen.
And I read online again another article I was kind of looking about, talking about salt. It says that why Epsom salt works in the garden. It says composed almost exclusively of magnesium sulfate. Epsom salt is intensely rich in these two minerals, which are both crucial to healthy plant life. These same minerals, which are so beneficial for bathing and household tasks, are also great for your garden, helping it reach its fullest potential and creating a lush and vibrant outdoor space. Unlike common fertilizers, Epsom salt does not build up in the soil over time, which makes it safer than using chemical soil supplements. So even in the world today, salt's such a great example from the Bible because it's so true. I mean, it's even used in gardening. It's used in, you know, people that produce crops and farming and all kinds of things. And a lot of times people, when they're testing soil, they test how much saltiness it has or what kind of levels it has, and it determines how healthy the soil is. You know, for certain crops, it might need more salt, and other crops, it might need less salt, depending on how much moisture that type of crop needs to be really fruitful. And you know, I think God knows how much salt we need in our lives to be fruitful. How much salt's going to help us. But go to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. I think this will kind of tie in a lot of the points that we've been looking at. A lot of the things that the Bible's been saying about salt. Because the Bible says that salt is good. Salt is good. Let's look at Matthew 5 verse 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went into the mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and he taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and giveth light unto all that are in his house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. So Jesus kind of brings it all together. He says, guess what? Ye are the salt of the earth. Who's the salt? His disciples. Notice who he's talking to at the beginning. He wasn't talking to everybody. He wasn't talking to every person that's saved. He's saying, look, you guys, you're going to be the salt of the earth. You're going to be the ones that go out and preserve this earth. You're going to be the ones that preserve souls from hell. You're going to be the ones that are the seasoning, the ones that are helping people not fall, the people that get the good taste of God in their mouth, that hear the word of God with truth, with grace. When they speak, it's seasoned with salt. Look, he's given them a lot of instructions. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the poor in spirit. They're going to have great seasoning of salt in their mouths. And he says salt is the same as being here the light of the world. Look, you got to go out and preach the gospel. But, you know, some guy that's super zealous, he's just on fire, he's so excited, but he doesn't have any Bible. He's never been salted. He's never gotten the word of God in his heart. He doesn't know any of the scriptures. He doesn't know where to turn. How good is he going to be? If the salt has lost its savor, it's good for nothing. I mean, you can be super excited, and that's great. That's wonderful. And, you know, when someone first gets saved, of course, they don't necessarily know anything. They got to start learning and growing. But as you start to get the more Bible in your life, as you start to get more salt in your life, you're going to be more effective. You're going to be more efficient. You're going to be better at going out and preaching the gospel. You're going to be a better light. You're going to be have more seasoning, more savor. Turn, if you would, to Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. The Bible says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We need the salt out there preaching the word of God so somebody can get saved. So we can preserve this world. So that we can get right with God. So that we can do big things for God. But how are they going to hear without a preacher? How are they going to get that healing without the salt? If you're the salt, and they need it for healing, how are they going to get it if you don't go?
Right.
You have a decision in your life today. Hey, you're important. You're the salt of the earth. You're the ones that's going to preserve people. You're the ones that's going to preserve this world. You're the one that's preserving God's wrath and judgment on the people. Aaron stood in front of God for the children of Israel. He said, as an intercessor, you have that ability. You have that privilege. You have the responsibility to be the salt of the earth. You say, oh, my life's not that important. I just go to this job. I just do this thing. No, you can be the salt of the earth. You have purpose. You have meaning. God's withholding his wrath because of what you're doing. If you go out and preach the gospel, if you're getting people saved, if you're following his commandments, ye are the salt of the earth. You're the one bringing the healing. You're the one preserving this world. It's so important. We see in Mark chapter 4, look at verse 14. The sower soweth the word, and these are they by the wayside, where the word is sown, but when they had heard, Satan cometh immediately, and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. And these are they likewise, which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word, immediately received it with gladness, and they have no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction and persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word, and receive it, and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. Now it's interesting, God's talking about, you know, sowing the word, sowing the seed. And there's so many parallels of what the Bible is, there's so many parallels of, you know, the earthly things and God making them spiritual things. But look at verse 20. He says, and these are they which are sown on good ground. It's interesting that he says good ground. Now how do you get the good ground? How did Elisha get the good ground? He put the salt in the water and then there was good ground. Then it became fruitful. Think about somebody out in this world. They need you. They need the salt to go out and help get that soil, you know, nice and fertile. Get that soil ready for that Word of God so that when they get it, they can become a soul winner. How are you going to get more soul winners? By having good salt. You know, if someone goes out there and, you know, they stumble around, they know the Bible well enough just to get the person saved, but they weren't really that excited. They weren't really that enthusiastic. They didn't have much savor. Maybe that person's not going to really want to get in church. Maybe that person doesn't want to come and get baptized. But when the person's just on fire for God, and everything that's coming out of the mouth just seasoned with so much salt, and this person takes a bite of the Word of God, they taste it and they say, I've never tasted anything like that. And they want to become a soul winner. They get that good ground. We say that the good ground is those that receive it. They really get excited. And then they can bring forth fruit. I mean, I can't think of anything more exciting than if I get somebody saved that then wants to become a soul winner, that then wants to get in church, that then wants to go out and produce more fruit. That's how we're going to do it. That you need the salt, though. You need it to be really salty. You need to have a lot of, be seasoned really well. And we need some soul winners with some salt. You know, just because you're going out and preaching the gospel, I mean, you got to have some saltiness. I mean, you got to have a little bit. But why don't you decide to get more seasoned? Why don't you get some more salt in your life? So then you can produce better fruit. I mean, not all fruit's the same. Some fruit's, you know, really big and juicy and great. Some fruit's just kind of, eh. I mean, you ever take a bite of like an apple or something, or like a mealy apple, and you're just like, eh. I mean, it's still fruit. I mean, you know, and I bet there's a lot of people that we've won to Christ that's probably not very good fruit. I mean, it probably wouldn't taste that great. But at least they're going to heaven, amen? I mean, right? But don't we want to produce good fruit? We got to get some good soil. So we got to get some salt out there. We got to get the Word of God out there. We got to be seasoned really well. So how does this apply to your life? I mean, we're, as salt, going to preserve the souls of this world. We're going to preserve our city. We're going to preserve this world. We see when we're seasoned, we can give better answers. We can give great answers. We can give answers that, you know, are filled with this Bible. We can be well-grounded. And as God said, we can be a sweet savor unto Him. You know, why do you want to be seasoned with salt? So you can be a sweet savor. God wants us to be a savor. I mean, He's not like eating us. But I mean, you think about this. Why do you put salt on your food? Because it tastes good. Because you want that good sensation. And lastly, He wants the fruit. He wants us to make other soul winners. But I think, you know, the only way you're going to get that good ground is with the salt. But you know, there's a lot of places in the United States that are barren. There's a lot of places in the United States where there's not any fruit being produced. What do they need? They need some salt. They need somebody to get really on fire for God. And they need the salt to be distributed. They need the salt to go into every city, to go into every town, into every village, into every nation. And we need the salt to go forth and to bring forth more fruit. You say, oh man, this city's not bringing forth any fruit. What does it need? It needs some salt. Jesus said, ye are the salt of the earth. Is there any city that's going to get saved or do great things for God if no salt goes there? If no man of God goes there? If no soul winners go there? No. It needs some salt. That's why we need a man of God in every city.
Amen.
And you say, why in the world do you want to be a pastor someday? You know, honestly, when I think about it, I don't know. There was definitely times when I grew up and I thought, you know, it'd be cool to be a pastor. Or, that's a really awesome job. Or I honestly thought it was the most important job in the world. But, I didn't really necessarily think too much of it. I thought a lot about, you know, being like a professional athlete or, you know, being a movie star. I had a lot of ideas as a kid, right? I mean, you have lots of ideas. You don't really know what you want to do. But then when I really started getting serious about the Word of God, when I started, you know, really paying attention to what people were saying, what the Bible said, you know, trying to really research God, I saw there's just a lack. I mean, there's just not very many people going out preaching the Word of God. There's not a good church in every city. I mean, the city that I was going to had like 200,000 people in it. And there was no salt in that city. It was barren. There was no one going out preaching the gospel. You know, all I wanted to do was just find some church that I could be a blessing to, that I could just serve at, that I could go out soul winning. And I think there's a lot of people like that. I think there's a lot of people in this nation and in this world. They want to do the right thing. They want to get on fire for God. They want a man of God that they can follow. Someone that will teach them the Bible. Someone that will teach them soul winning. Someone that will teach them how to do the right thing. But they don't have it. That's why we need more salt in this world. Maybe that's your calling in this world. You say, I don't know what my life's like. I don't know what I want to do with my life. Why don't you decide to be some salt somewhere?
Amen.
Why don't you decide to do big things for God, and so you can bring forth more fruit? You know, you can be some salt somewhere, and then you can get more people. Get some salt, get some more salt. Start reproducing. You know, things bring forth after their own kind. I think some really good salt can bring forth some more really good salt. But you know, the salt's lost its savor. You know, I was thinking about these churches. Why do they, you know, what does it mean to lose your savor? Well, what if the church, you know, is on fire for God, but then they just stop, you know, go soul winning? They say, well, you know, it's cold outside, it's dark, nobody's really showing up. Let's just cancel soul winning for a few months and then we'll come back to it. And then they never really do. And then they're not going out preaching the gospel anymore. And now it's been a year, it's been 2 years. Now, you know, they're not even really preaching the Bible anymore because nobody really knows it. Nobody really, you know, it says you become a forgetful hearer if you're not doing the Word of God.
Amen.
And then what happens? That salt loses its savor slowly. It slowly starts to deteriorate. It becomes old. And then guess what happens? There's no more fruit.
Right.
We need the salt to have good savor. We need these churches that are just dying and decaying and losing all their saltiness to just get back on fire with God. The only way you're going to do that is by going out soul winning, by preaching the gospel, by getting on fire for God. But you know, when it loses its savor, it's good for nothing. What is a big, you know, ivory tower, King James Bible-only church doing when they don't have any soul winning, no outreach program? What does God look at that church and think?
Dead.
It's good for nothing. It's worthless.
Right.
Is He going to preserve it? Is God going to preserve that church? No, they don't have any salt. You know, it's interesting, they say, well, we don't want to go soul winning because we don't want to lose people. We don't want people to get offended. No, that's how you're going to lose your church if you don't have soul winning. If you're not being salt, you're not going to be preserved yourself.
Yep.
All these churches are dying and they're decaying, and when the baby boomers leave, they're going to be gone. There's going to be so many churches that are empty houses if we don't get some more salt in this world. If we don't get some people on fire for God. Our nation's in trouble. We need more salt. And I'll close with Luke chapter 14. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land, nor yet for the dunghill, but men cast it out. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. God wasn't talking about table salt when He said that. He was talking about His disciples. He was talking about that, those that wanted to follow Him. He said the salt is good. You can know that if you're doing things for God, if you're on fire for God, if you're preserving this world, if you're preserving, you know, souls, if you're going out being a seasoning, God says that's good. Let's close in prayer. Thank You, Jesus Christ, for Your Word. Thank You so much for the truths that You give us. I pray that everyone in this room would see the importance of just having our salt in our lives, of being salt, of knowing that it's great importance, that we have great value in Your sight, and that we are the ones that are preserving this world if we're doing what You said. I just pray that You just be a blessing on this church, that we could go forth and we could have much fruit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.